Recording in progress.
We talk about soil today. Soil is a pavement material and it's well as it's a supporting material. So the knowledge of soil is very important to know about the highway materials. So soil properties that we are going to discuss today will be have the following content: soil formation, soil types, particle size analysis and grading characteristics, physical properties of soil, and engineer classifications of the soil. Soil is a product of several processes whose rates are controlled over time by factors found in a given landscape. The soil forming processes result in characteristics layers in the soil called horizons. It's very important to know the horizons. Because of the horizon, you can know where your foundation would be, especially while you are talking about your pile for infrastructures or even laying your pavement layer over that soil. So the soil profile, we can say, is a vertical slice from the surface through all the horizons to the relatively unaltered parent material. And specific profile types are found in specific locations in different landscapes. So this is also the basis of the soil classification. Now, if we look back how the soil is formed, and we know that soil is formed as a result of the processes acting on the superficial geological material. This starting material is called the parent geological material. And all of the parent materials have different characteristics. The parent geological material found at site is one factor which affects the rate and degree to which soil forming processes develop the land, develop the soil. And it is very essential as a highway engineer to know what parent material the soil has got. You know, in Karachi, most of the soil we get from the rocks, it's a very good base material, and it is eroded from the metamorphic rocks, which is, you know, commonly known as Morum soil, and it's a very good pavement material. So if you have a parent material like sedimentary rocks and you've got the soil, the residual soil, it's very good. Similarly, we used to have a very good soil from Malir Nadi, and people have used it many years and years. It's a very good, a very good satisfaction level. So even that soil is very useful. So we must know what is the horizon, what is the origin of that soil, and obviously we are not going to get it till we inspect the soil. Till we have those SPT tests, or even for the pavement, as a pavement engineer, pavement investigation. Normally for pavement, we have 1 meter by 1 meter by 1 meter trench excavated, and we get the sample of the soil from there. Sometimes we also get the layering effect if there have been a previous pavement on that, or any other factor that could help us, or even the groundwater table. Normally the groundwater table, we use SPT test, but if you just dig up 1 meter by 1 meter, 1 meter deep trench, and you find that there is a water, then you have a problem. So you have to either know the source of the water, and that's very important. You know, what happens is that if the water is not local, it has come from somewhere else, then you have to find the source. But sometimes if the water is local, we have to dig deep so that we, you know, whether that's a well or something, we have gone, or maybe it because of the some water line that has been buried previously, and with this, you know, with years and years, it has been recovered from the soil. Sometimes, you know, when you are digging and you are exploring the material, you have, you know, trees and something like that, and you don't know what's beneath it. So it's very important to know the soil forming process, and especially for pavement in India, we are very, you know, we are very cautious about the water table location, because if the water table is location is very near, then we have a problem for the pavement. So not only the pavement is destroyed from the water from the above, but it is also affected by the water from the beneath. And the water from the beneath is more dangerous than the water from the top. Now let's see how the soil formation take place. We all know that the rocks and minerals are the major source of the soil, and they can be either broken down by physical phenomena or a chemical process. From the physical process, the source may be the gravity, running water, wind, freeze thaw, glaciation, and then impact that has been caused by the above process. The chemical processes that have resulted in the soil may be dissolution, hydrolysis, carbonation, and oxidation. So people have identified the buried material, the soil, like this, that for a material, if the material is fluvial, it means it has been deposited by the running water, and that's where the type of soil we will get is gravel, sand, and silt. And if the material is lacustrine, that has been in the lakes, and that the source of the material will be fine sand, silt, or clay. If it is a morainal, then it is, the source is glaciers, and it has heterogeneous mix. Then if it is ilion, then it's a wind, and the material will, can be classified as sand and silt. And if it is colluvial, it's gravity, and it can be of any size. So size of the particle of the soil will define you the source, how it comes from. So we say, if there is a soil, the horizon of the soil, there are four processes. Addition, in which the addition of organic material took place from plants, water, air, and energy from the sun. Losses include water due to evaporation or transpiration, and nutrients leaching from the soil. Translocation include the movement of clay, organic matter, and nutrients from one tract to other. And transformation includes the formation of the clay and arrangement of the soil components into structural aggregates. People say that the parent material do not have to be a rock. Normally we find this thing. In order for a parent material to be residual, the soil must develop directly from the bedrock. Basalt weather slowly, and it's high in iron, which imparts a red color to the soil. In some area, limestones or granite can be a parent material from a residual soil. That's what I was talking about, the soil we get from the rocks of, say, Kati Pahadi, or the rocks of Nazibabad, or sometimes we excavate a soil in the Gulistan Jaur area. All of them are of limestone origin, and that's why I said it's a very good material, especially the filling material, or we call a very good base material. This is something from Western slides. This is what we called basalt and residual soil. that has been resulted from the remains of the soil or from the top of the rocks. So if the materials are transported, primary materials, they are based on, they are divided into four groups based on the method of transportation: water, wind, gravity, and ice. So we say water is an effective means of moving earth materials. In fact, it is the main agent responsible for the leveling of mountains and filling of valleys. Parent material deposited by moving water are called alluvium. And alluvial soil have different strata, three distinct strata. Each strata will have a different composition depending on the speed of the water then deposited the stream. And that's why I was, when I was referring the soil from Malir Nadi, was very good soil. The world must be wondering why we do not have the soil from Liari Nadi. Would it be as effective as the Malir Nadi? You know, over the years, because of other things, and the, you know, Liari Nadi is more polluted than the Malir Nadi, and that was the reason. And you know, if you go on superhighways, you will find the mountains, and you will find all the water is flowing towards from superhighways towards Malir Nadi. So all the rocks that are being eroded from that superhighway, it generally flow to the Malir River. It's, you know, it's, you know, naturally it's like this, and that's why we have a very good material from Malir Nadi. However, you know, 4 years ago, it's, you know, it's lost its productivity, and the person, you know, is now we are not getting, we are getting the material now from Balochistan or superhighway materials near Hamdard University. So from granite you can have this residual soil, and so again it's a very good soil as a highway material. Then from volcanoes in Hong Kong, they have this residual vesicle soil again. It's a good material. So when we see when a material is wind deposited, sand, eolian sand, which can be effective transporter of parent materials. They are wind deposits, silt lois, lus, we say. Pronounced as lus. When silt particles are blown and deposited by the wind, the material is called lus. Normally, as a highway material, we don't use that soil. Not normally, we don't use that soil at all, because it's a very small size particle silt. And usually, when we have this deposit, we remove that deposit. And if the deposits are very deep, then we have to replace it with some material. The silt is dangerous material as a for a pavement. This is a colluvium material. This material is brought by the gravity. They are not rounded, and that's a very good soil get material we get for the aggregates, the solubium or gravity, and you know, their preservation does not take place, and that's why we prefer that material as a rock. Or even if you have a subgrade soil, what we call this material can be used as improved subgrade. Can be, actually it is used as a improved subgrade material in areas where we have a very less resistive soil in terms of CBR, or very less reactive soil. So this is the example of the wind soil, gravity soil. This is outwashed sands and gravels. This is the plain that are used for the gravel soil or the crush aggregates. Now, this is another another source ice. These are materials that are transported and deposited by glaciers. Moraines are made of unsorted material. The glacier got enough out of the earth, slid across the landscape, and the still is piled at the end of the glacier. It is called terminal moraine. And actually, I cannot say this can be a very good material because they are very rich in silted clay. And then in areas where the meltwater moving away very fast, these are called outwash, look very similar to alluvial deposit. And then there is an esker, low hill that was formed by an ice, deposited very coarse materials because the water was moving very fast. A cairn is also formed on the side, but it was a large hole in ice as a system form of the landform is a hill. So this is some of the pictures of the glacial tills. So broadly, we can classify soil in four categories: sand, grail, gravels, silts, clays, and organics. Obviously, as you go from top to bottom, our lichenous as highway material change to dislike. For example, if we want to explore that soil, so if it is a loose sand, it can be excavated with a spade. And you can take 50 mm, means 2-inch wooden peg, and you can just drive it very easily. And if it is a dense sand, then you have to require a pick for excavation. And then you have to use something to drive a 50 mm or 2 inches wooden peg into it. And if it is cemented, which you have to have visual examinations, pick removes or soils in lumps, which can then be abraded to form your sites. When you have a silt, you can easily mold and crush in the figures. And if it is dense, you can be molded or crushed by strong pressure in the figures. If it is clay, it's very soft. It's, you know, tends to occupy your hand. It's not very easy. You can mold it by light pressure. You can be molded by strong flesh pressure and stiff. Cannot be indented by the thumbnail. And if it is organic pit, so you can be indented by the thumbnail, the firm fibers, very compressed together, spongy and plastic. So this is, you know, during recce, if you are, or even, you know, have been given a site to start working on it, just from, you know, the feel of it, you can understand what type of soil this would have been. Then obviously there are other ways, and there are more scientific way to classify a soil. If it is a coarse grained soil, then we do Savey analysis. If it is fine grained soil, then we see hydrometric method, and then there's a grading characteristics. So you can see the difference between boulder and cobble, as the figure suggests. One greater than 12 inch, a person can stand on it. But if it is 3 to 12, a person can lift it. So, you know, standing on it or lifting it, the two other things. This is how you can classify the boulder with the cobbles. this is one view of the sieve you already know. And then there's a individual sieve and they are stacked in mechanical shaker. So this is how you can see, this is a coarse gravel, this is a fine gravel, coarse sand, medium sand, and the fine sand. And this is the hydrometric analysis, you know, to go for this, to know, classify the soil. And this is how, if this is T1, T2, and gradually, the more the settlement, the more you know it's a fine sand. Then another way, you know, for you knowing is drawing this semi-log graph, the percentage passing. So this sand is actually a gravel, medium gravel to a fine sand. This is the end point, this is the starting point, and this is the curve. You all know this. So if your size is between 0.002 to 0.06, then it's a silty clay. This is a sand because it ends on the sand. You know, start with this point, and most of the region is silt from this point, and it ends at sand. So this will be called sandy silt. Now, if it is a very fine, you can see that it starts from silt and it ends up this at sand, and it's a medium sized sand. Then this curve, it starts from the sand and it ends on the sand, right? This. So we call this a well-graded sand. And if, you know, the curve starts from the sand and the majority of this curve area, you can see more than 60%. You see, this is 40% and the rest is 60%. 60% lies in this range of gravel. So we call this well-graded gravel. Well-graded gravel that it has got all the, you have a size of say 20% or 0.6, then 2 mm is 40%. Then, you know, so it's a well-graded gravel, all this thing. Sometimes this type of curve, it's where you say, although it's well-graded sand, but you know, this is what we call an open-ended as well, because many size may be missing or it's very small in number. Usually, what size you do is, you know, Unified Soil Classification System, that is USCS, particle size ranges. So you have always, if the material is retained on 12 inch, that it means it is greater than 12 inch. If the material has passed 12 inch and retained on 3 inch, so it is between 3 to 12 inches. So it is quobble, right? And now if you have if the material has passed 3 inch and it's retained on 3 by 4 inch, then we call this as a coarse gravel, right? And then you so on and so forth. Normally, what you say that number 4 is the dividing line. All material that is retained on number 4, it's a coarser material. And that pass number 4 but retain on 200, then it's a fine material. And those who have passed number 200 material, we call this as a mineral filler. Or technically, that soil will be easily classified as something that is between silt and clay. So obviously, for the coarse material, you will have a sieve analysis. And for minus 200 materials means, minus 200 material means those who have passed 200 number sieve. It's a very small size. about 0.075 mm, or what you call 7.5 microns. So, you know, there are different categories of the soil and how this is generally classified. Knowing by sieve analysis, you can know what type of soil that you have encountered. Basically, if you look at the big scenario, you see the strength of the boulder is more than the strength of the fine sand. Right? In terms of California bearing ratio, CBR. And when we say, actually, there are always, you know, how you can classify a sieve, you take one linear inch, and then within a one linear inch, you know, if there are four square, then it's a number four sieve, it's eight squares, then accordingly. Now, actually, the size, if I say number four, it doesn't mean it's point, four means 0.25. The opening is not 0.25. It is less than 0.25 because there are the size of the wires as well. So in between that size, the maximum size may be 0.25 between center to center of the wire, but the actual opening is 1.187 inches, right? So normally if you say 1 inch that divided by four, it's 0.25 inch. The opening is not 0.25 inches because of the wire diameter. So this is how the curves are drawn. So you see, all you need to know is this is fine, this is sand and gravel. So if you try to locate what this type of sign, this black curve, it's a sand. Because it's majority of 100%, 100% passing by weight means 0% retain, right? And 25% or 28% passing by weight is 72%. If the material is passing from 0.00 inch, it's passing 28%. Then where the rest materials go? 72% has been retained. So this is how you can classify this is a soil, it's a gravel, and then what you can see is what the majority, where the majority of the particle size lie. When we say well graded, means it has a very good range of signs. It has, you know, it has a fine material, it has a coarse material, and every range. And we say poorly graded means it has, you know, uniform size material. So if we want to know why we are interested in coarse grained soil, is if they are well graded mixtures, they are more stable, less compressible, less permeable, because you have a smaller size, you have a higher size. So the slots are filled automatically. If they have got 10%, more than 10% clay, then permeability will be dominated. And if it is more than 30% clay, then it's dominated by strength. Mostly, when you draw a curve, you find the coefficient of uniformity and coefficient of curvature that also help you in classifying the soil. So D60 means, you know, what you do is 60% of the fine you intersect with the curve, and when you go perpendicular, you see this is the size obviously on the x-axis. So you know this is a D60 soil, percentage passing 60, and then you know this 30% and this is 10%. So there is a coefficient of uniformity and the coefficient of curvature. Then there is a consistency indices. clays and sands are cells are characterized by the variation in the behavior with the change in water content, and it's very important in their plastic behavior. So what happens is that the soil volumes, if you have a low percentage of water, you have low soil volume, and if this is what called semi-pastel plastic solid, and there is a percentage of the water content decrease, you can have what called a natural water content. There is a solid state, then there's semi-plastic solid states, then the plastic state, and then there's a liquid. So if you have a liquid, and you know, if this is what we call a quicksand condition, you cannot have this foundation or the pavement in it. And if it is semi-solid, it's a very good material. So, you know, this consistency in diet says, you know, the Atterberg limits, they are between your liquid limit and the plastic limit. So if your liquid intensity is less than zero, then it's a brittle solid. If it is liquidity index, there's a shrinkage limit, there's a plastic limit, and there is a liquid limit. As it goes from zero water content to increasing water content. So if this like this, it's a very good stress strain curve. But if it is the liquid index between 0 and 1, you will find this is a very unpredictable behavior. And obviously, if it is like this, there is no strength in it. There is no stress strain in it. It's a very poor soil length. So how you do it, you know, you spread that material and try to roll it with your finger. This all, you know, from your undergraduate practical, how you classify the soil and how you find the limit. So if you have a plasticity index greater than 35, it's a very high potential swelling shrinkage soil. 20 to 48, 12 to 32, and if it is less than 18, it's a low soil. And you know, our desire for increasing the soil increases, selecting the soil and confidence in the soil increase as we go from greater than 35 to less than 18 plasticity index. This is the Casa Grande cup. You always know from your background how you find this, and there's a cup, and then you have to fill that slot and wedge, and then you find, keep on adding water. So this is a Casa Grande tools. There's a 10 millimeter gauge for checking height of the cup. There's a remolded soil, height of the fall of the cup, and just strike it and you see. So this is how you classify the soil, moist water content, and log number of blows. There's this Casa Grande is used on the soil. It has got passing number 200. Cannot be used for a coarse grain soil. All materials that have been passed for 200, because it is then categorized as a dust or clay material, then it's shown liquidity index and plasticity index from that Casa Grande analysis or test. Another way is to use this cone penetration method. It is both same, somewhat identical to what we do in penetration test for asphalt. The same thing, but you know the needle is different here. This we already discussed. So different agencies have classified these four categorized four types of soil according to their size. There is a uniform soil classification, there is a Massachusetts Institute of Technology classification, there is the H2, and there is a British standards. Mostly in this part of the world, we use either unified soil classification or H2 classification, or we can say we are comfortable with this classification system. So if you are talking about gravel, it's between 3 to 0.2 mm or greater than 2 mm in H2. Sand is between 0.2 mm to 0.003 and 0.08 to 0.002 is the size specified by H2. H2 is on the lower side, you can see. Silt is something less than 0.003 fines, and you know the there is no size for clay by USC. However, there is 0.8 micron size that is being given for by H2. When we're talking about the horizon, we say there can be four horizons. There are four horizons: A horizon, B horizon, C horizon, and D horizon. We go from top to bottom. That if the darker color soil has accumulated because of proposed organic layer, that's topsoil. B horizon, zone of accumulation, usually a fine texture. Then A horizon, and often red in color. C horizon, weathered rock. And the horizon is the consolidated underlying bedrock. This is how you can see that soil profile. This is the top soil where you can usually your plant grow. The root goes like this, and there is after that subsoil. And that's why when we are constructing a pavement, we say this is a subgrade, because the top soil we already removed. That's why it's called a subgrade, and or we call it subsoil or zone of accumulation. Then we call this as a foundation, partially decomposed parent material and aerated. So if you are talking about the pile, obviously you will try to reach here. And if you're talking about pavement, this depth is enough for you. Even this, anything you rest your pavement after removing the soil, that's a normally, a pavement you go is, you know, what you do, you excavate it. It says that, you know, usually a 6 inch of soil has to be removed most of the time. So if your 6 inch of the soil is removed and sometime you start constructing the pavement, so that's, you know, and normally the pavement is not more than 1 meter. So 1 meter means how many? 3 feet, you know, 3.28 feet. And this is a more color picture of what we call high horizon. Brown color, then there's a red, and there's barely altered, and there's unaltered. Another way is, you know, what we call basic soil horizons, the rotting plants. Rotting plants and finally decomposed rock, B horizon, decomposed rock, C slightly decomposed rock, and R is the rock. So O, A, B, C, R. Soil, another way, one way is to classify the soil, how, where it is being transported, gravity, wind. Another way is to have a grain size classification. Another way is to know the horizons, at which horizon it is. One or the other way is to classify with respect to permeability. So when you say it's a homogeneous, it means permeability is dependent on position within the soil. Heterogeneous means permeability is dependent on the position with the soil. And isotopic material permeability is dependent on the direction of the measurement. So soil is a heterogeneous and isotropic material. That is, it is dependent on the position with the soil, and it is dependent on the direction of the measurement. Let's come about the physical properties of the soil, its texture, structure, bulk density, pore space, and soil temperature. So the relative portion of a soil is covered by the class of texture shown in figure 1. A continuum exists between sand and clay texture. You can see this is sand at the round, and in between that, you know, the deepest portion is silt, and between sand and silt there's a clay. There's sand, there's silt, and then there's a clay. You can always know, if you know the percentage clay, you know the percentage silt, and percent by use this triangulation. If you have 50% passing, you will go, and sometime you end up this point. Percent clay, 20%, you go like this, and if it is, you know, have this 40% silt. So this can be a clay loam. This, if so anything fall, but this is this clay loam, this silt clay loam, this silt sand, then there is anything in this region is clay, and this is sand. Usually this or the chart we call as a texture, and usually this type of classification is used by Massachusetts Institute of Technology, this triangulation form. So we can say we find the structure as a granular, as you can see. The blocky means irregular blocks that are usually 1.5 to 5 mm. Then there's a prismatic like this. There's columnar like, then there's a platy structure, and then there's a single red soil. So structure can vary from granular to blocky to prismatic to columnar to platy and single grain. When talk about the property bulk density, the mass of the dry density soil divided by the volume, it is, you know, kilogram per cubic meter of what to call this. Then bulk density is always taken less than particle density, because the bulk density, the volume of the soil and the voids are considered. And when if it is particle density, you don't consider the void at subtract the points. Particle density, the density of the soil particles, the dry mass of the particles being divided by the solid. Volume of the water in contrast with bulk density. Particle density of the soil is 2.65 gram per centimeter cube. And how you will determine bulk density is determined by removing a 200 to 250 gram of clod of soil, drying it in an oven to remove water, weighing the oven dried clod. Volume is determined by recording the amount of water displaced when the cold clod is placed in a beaker of water. Because soils are porous, they must be sealed with a waterproofing compound. Usually the weight of this compound can be ignored in the computation. There is a pore space. It results from the irregular shape of the soil particles from pushing and aggregation force. When pore space is very small, soil change retain water and impede drainage, resulting in poor aeration. Pore size is more important than the total pore space. So if you look at the components of the soil, it has got mineral matter, then there's organic matter, then water and air. So of clay soil means what? More mineral matter. And sandy soil means the four components are always there. This mineral matter can be, clay, this can be a sandy soil, depending on the size of the material. So if you are graveler soil, there's a good movement of water, you can see. This is how this bulk density, you can see that density of clay is 1 as compared to the density of sand, that is 1.55. And that's why, and the porosity is lower as can. So this definition gives you something, a food of thought for you. You know, what happened as I was referring to that classical example of copy and paste. When you got a material that has got bulk density 1.55, it cannot have low CBR. It cannot have low porosity. It should have low porosity. And if you have a loam or something that has got bulk density around 1, then it may not have a CBR of 30 or CBR of 20. So these numbers means a lot to you. Normally, how do I remember these type of number is I always know that for concrete RCC, I always use 150 PCF. So if the soil is around 150 PCF, it's a very good soil. If the soil has that, this density less than 150 PCF or all of that. So, this always is a guideline for you. To always remember, refer the number to that. That will be easy to remember, and you always remember those figures while what is the density of the concrete. More density means a very good soil, less density, a very poor soil. This will also be supplemented by your sieve analysis. And if the soil classification says sand, could not have a bulk density of 1.10 something. It's always a cross check, you must know. These are something that may not be interested, but let's take it like this. It's a take a lot of energy to raise the temperature of the water. Conversely, water retains heat. So if water log will soil will heat up in the spring planting, soils may become water log from strong. Soil normally allow water downward, but these mini joints can become clogged. As a pavement engineer, if the water, if the land is water logged, then we have a problem because of the high water table. You have to get rid of it. Not only there is a water table, but there is a salt as well. So we have to, have some, we have to install some French drains, some underground subsoil water collection system to get rid of that water. Otherwise, it will be very dangerous for the pavement. Pavement will also be. So let's go to the soil classification. This you already knew, but for the sake of this class, I'm repeating it. Predicts subgrade performance of a given soil on the basis of few simple types. H2 classification, and there's mechanical analysis, then test performance soil winder, and unified soil classification. What is the purpose? Classify soils into groups with similar behavior in terms of simple indices can provide geotechnical engineer a general guidance about engineering properties of the soil. So simple indices are grain size distribution, liquid limit, and plasticity index. GSD means grain size distribution. So this classification is the language, and then it estimates the engineering properties, and based on those properties, we have our own goals, our purpose, whether you have to pull up, construct, lay a pile on it, or you will have a simple isolated foundation, or you have a mat foundation, or you may have, depending on the soil classification. As I said, so there are different ways classification, but USCIS and American Association of State Highway Transportation Officials are the most common way of classifying the soil.